Reach this place now. I think I spent them more than 1.5 hours in the taxi. Please be with me, and then definitely I will give you some information related to glaucoma. Okay. Okay. So I think before going to the topic, you know, the take-home message. You know, I will tell you the take-home message because you are already exhausted. Your signature is written on your blood. Okay, you have to understand that one. Your signature is written on your blood. In the sense, there is already variation in the in your genome. So based on the genetics, so 50% of the genetics, you know, I'm talking about concern with ophthalmology. So 50% of that diseases related to the genetics, you know. So that's what your the signature is pre-written. If there is any change in your signature, so the onset of the disease either in the early onset or in the late onset. So I think people talked about early onset and late onset. So here I'm talking about the glaucoma because we extensively studied from cornea to the optic nerve, many, many diseases. Here I'm going to focus only on the glaucoma because it's a very, very late onset. I think ophthalmologist, you know, I think without seeing slide, you know, I'll be better to interact with you guys. So concerned with the onset, like a classification of glaucoma, please recall the classification of the glaucoma, the juvenile open angle glaucoma, and then after 35, you know, the onset is primary open angle glaucoma, normal tension like that. So here, some of the genetic marker, I told you that your signature is written on your blood. So concerned with the genetics, even though the Human Genome Project is completed, 19,000 genes are there, and then 600 genes for ocular genes, only 600. You target with the 600 genes, definitely, you know, I think the one way or another is associated with some diseases. Either it is in the anterior chamber or in the posterior chamber, right? So here, concerned with the glaucoma, I'm focusing only on the primary open angle glaucoma. So the primary open angle glaucoma, so far, only like including congenital glaucoma genes, some 4 genes are there. Myosilin, optineurin, WDR36, and CYPN gene. Only 4 genes. But you know, in addition to the 4 genes, some genes are is a crosstalk with the, those candidate genes. You know, it is playing a major role in the pathogenesis of the glaucoma. Again, right now, an excellent article is published. It means they compiled for the past 3 decades, 3,000 papers, and then they written one particular review that is called POGOM. You know, that is called POGOM. It means what are the, oh, sorry. What are the genes involved in that particular glaucoma that is called the POGOM? So I'm going to focus on that. You are a clinician, I think definitely, you know, concerned with the glaucoma, okay, the first degree relatives are prone to develop primary open angle glaucoma. That is definite. It means heterozygous. So the POAG is a heterozygous, the first degree relatives, it means one meiosis away from one particular thing, you know, that is they're prone to develop the, if it's a father or mother having the disease, definitely the son or daughter having the chance is very high. That's what a early onset or late onset. 45 years, you know, better to check, you can recommend to the patient and the family members, I think you already developed the glaucoma, the chance is very high, the first degree relatives, why not you come to the hospital after 45, regularly check the intraocular pressure. That is the recommendation you're supposed to give. So, I mean, obviously genetic is very, very needed, I mean, for at least to improve your healthcare. Once you understand what exactly your genome, is there any problem in your genome, you can change your lifestyle. You know, Natarajan talked about AMD. So previously, once you identified, you know, the variation for AMD, you can postpone the onset of the disease. That's what I'm telling you. You can't able to stop the disease, but you can postpone the onset of the disease. For AMD, the other factors involved, you know, if you consume a lot of fat or alcohol, smoking and alcohol, that is trigger the disease, you know, the other factors involved. Once if you understand this, your signature is there for AMD, you can postpone the onset. Okay, so this is our role for the clinician, especially those who are doing genetics. You know, you have to well document it means you have to make your own registry. That is very, very important. If it is a very unique case, I mean, better to pay more attention and then you do many, many things. So obviously that should be very, very confidential and you should not reveal that thing. Maybe you can take a photograph. And then this is our study.
You know, as I told you, the first degree relatives, you know, we have taken large number of sample and then we are analyzing the siblings and everything. Definitely they are prone for the first relative degrees. I mean, first generation have more chance to get the disease. So this is the pathophysiology. I think you are all guys are ophthalmologists. I know I don't want to teach you right now the biology of the glaucoma. So basically it's a two types, primary open angle and then angular closure glaucoma. And why these are the very, I think I can put it in a different way. The aqueous humor is flowing through ciliary body and then it's draining out through episcular vein. So if there is any mutation happen, you know, as I told you, the candidate gene or associated genes, the mutated protein, you know, that is linking with the normal and abnormal protein, if it is forming a complex, that is nothing but the extracellular matrix. So you are telling is the extracellular matrix, that is nothing but the protein-protein interaction. So it is blocking the meshwork. Obviously, it is increasing intraocular pressure. People, I mean, the patient is losing the peripheral vision. They have only the central vision. So these are the main reason why they are, I mean, formation of the glaucoma. So one is the it's a formation of the cross-linked actin network, abnormal development of the extracellular matrix, and then decrease in phagocytosis. This is the main three reasons for the formation of primary open-angle glaucoma. As I told you, right now, that review article, you know, the 3,000 papers review article. So here, I think the learning has happened till death. You know, every day you have to learn some new things. So when I read this particular paper, so we are usually what we'll say is a neurodegenerative disorder, and then it is a complex disease. We will say it's a complex disease. He put a fancy word, you know, I think in between the one sentence is incredibly complex. You can read that one. POAG is a incredibly complex. It means he understood after reading the 3,000 paper what exactly going on to understand the pathogenesis. That's what, you know, I am carefully looking why he put incredibly complex. Okay, to understand the pathogenesis. And I think I don't want to go in detail about the thing. I want to educate only one thing here. You have to understand, you know, if the gene is mutated, obviously we are calling the phenotype and the phenotype and genotype correlation. But in glaucoma, there are intermediate phenotypes are there. That is called endophenotypes. So that is nothing but the intraocular pressure and the cup dish ratio, central corneal thickness, everything. So that is playing a major role. It means you have to select the patient. That's what I'm telling. You know, when you select the patient very carefully, stringent the clinical criteria, then only you can be able to do perfect genetics. So if it is a central corneal thickness, you recruit only those patients in a huge number. So like that, you know, that is the samples recruitment is very important when you go for genetic study. I think I don't want to go in detail. This is the complex. See here. The pathways involved in the pathogenesis of primary open angle glaucoma. It's a huge, I mean, incredibly complex. So we are, you can see some yellow dots. I think I may worked on for the past 2 decades. I produced even 6 PhDs, 20 papers, 15 papers like that. But you know, I can't be able to deal with many things. Only very few things we can able to understand how whatever we identified that mechanism involved in the pathogenesis. Okay, so this is, I told you, if you are really interested in the field of glaucoma, I think read this paper. This is called Characterization of the POGM. This is published from University of Pennsylvania. And so what they did, so I think the long story short, you know, I think I don't read that paper, turn the direction of the slide. See what they did, you know, like they're talking about some many genes, more than 600 genes, 550 genes. Are there associated with the primary open angle glaucoma. Okay, so they are categorized, beautifully characterized, you see here. So based on optic nerve disc gene analysis, it means they are segmented all the 5 categories. They are giving some criteria. What gene is associated with the juvenile open angle? What gene is associated with the ocular hypertension, normal tension, primary, like that, you know, they segregated each other. And then see this number, you know, the 62, one particular thing, 47, like that, you know, they categorized, you add everything, you know, that the end with, I mean, 550 genes. So through this, we can able to understand what pathophysiology of the primary open angle glaucoma. That is possible, okay? So here, the idea behind this particular review article of the combining all the 3,000 papers, okay? So, you know, we are very good in bioinformatics. So you pull all the data, and then you can find out in the pathway analysis, is there any single gene is crosstalking with those categories, you know, whatever I showed it to you. So is there any crosstalk? See, if it is a single gene, you know, we can make it as a marker for the particular primary open angle. That is possible. But here, the answer is, there is no single gene, single disease. As I told you, it is not a single gene, single disease. It's a polygenic inheritance. Many genes are involved, but they can't be able to come up with one particular gene responsible for primary open angle glaucoma. So what they did, you know, but the TGA beta 1, you know, it's a very, very interesting thing. So when you measure the aqueous humor, okay, you take the aqueous humor from the patient, when you measure the level of TGA beta 1, I think Radhika knows about, you know, some of the TGA beta gene alone is associated with the corneal dystrophies. That is different story. Even you can correlate with that one to the primary open angle glaucoma. Here, the TGA beta 1, 2, 3, you know, there are 3 TGA betas and then receptors 3. It means 6 genes are associated with the primary open angle glaucoma. So what they're telling here, if you are really interested, you know, I think I can able to talk hours. So if you're really interested, you know, I'm free to, because I have too much of commitments this morning from Department of Biotechnology just now. I'm here. Please, if you're really interested, interact with me. We'll discuss in detail. So what I'm trying to say is, sir, I will take 1 2 minutes, sir. 2 minutes. So I think you can in the review, you can see the third column. So what is the contribution, you know, all over the world, you know, they are categorizing in region wise. The third category is in South Asia. So South Asia in the sense, so what are the publication is there and who is working on that? And like that, you know, what is their contribution? How that one is related to this particular review? I think we falls under that particular category. I think this is our contribution for the past 2 decades. You know, we extensively studied many, many things like that. You know, I think I will stop it here. Very one interesting thing here. See, you know, we are not dealing with only genes. You know, we are cloning that particular gene and then we are transfecting that particular gene and then in the trabecular mesenteric cells and whether that the protein is going out of the cell or inside the cell, we are mimicking exactly what is happening in the glaucoma. So that is the, you can see here one mutator form, you know, that is accumulated inside the cell. The protein is not coming out of the cell. This is the, confocal microscopy photograph. I think we did a multicentric study with the many, many thing. See here, the TGA beta 3, if you measure the TGA beta 2 level is very, 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 very high in POAG patients in aqueous humor. I think we did a lot of animal model too. We have a zebrafish model. And this is one very interesting family, a POAG family. Like 450 members, 5 generation, we collected some of them, 20 of them are POAG, 20 of them are suspect. The interesting thing is, all the known genes are negative for this one. That is the very bingo. You know, we can able to identify a gene responsible for this particular family. So we did the GWAS, genome-wide association studies, and then we identified a rare variant. You know, you forget about the candidate genes like that. Here, when you know the bioinformatics, even the rare variant is, making a major role in the disease. So that is the outcome. I presented this in this particular paper in Vancouver last year. This is that particular, I don't know where I am. So ultimately, okay, so here, long story short,
you have another speaker.
Okay. So I think it's a very, very multigenic. So when you want to find out a biomarker or a genetic marker for a disease, you have to target with multiple markers, not a single marker. That is the bottom line for POAG. I think, you know, we understood many, many things. This is another story now. Even the TM, trabecular mesenteric cells having a stem cell, you know, that's what we are working on in our lab. And this is the final slide. The current testing recommendation, even from Harvard, you know, Boston, Jenny Wicks, she is telling the same story. You know, juvenile open angle glaucoma onset before 35 with a positive family history, definitely there is a myosin mutation. Or if it is a very late onset, POAG 50 years with a family history, you can jump into the myosin gene and then you can identify the mutation is positive for that one. Okay, I think I'll end up with this slide. Again, when I see this slide, I'm seeing it as a glaucoma. See, I think the patients are, I mean, having only the central vision. They are not getting the periphery. You can see the brightness from the sun in the center, not in the periphery. Okay, so you mean the glaucoma patients, they are losing the peripheral vision. They are getting only the central vision. Exactly, that's what I put this particular slide for glaucoma, and how we are going to extend this particular brightness to the periphery. That is our challenges. I think we have to work it out. Thank you very much.
And now we're kind of a little bit infringe, unfortunately, on the next session.